बुटोल 10 कालिका नगर अवस्थित कालिका मानव ज्ञान माध्यमिक विद्यालय र बुद्ध सामुदायिक टेलिभिजन को संयुक्त प्रयास में सञ्चालन भइरहेको एसी तयारी विशेष कक्षा में विद्यार्थी भाई बहनीहरुलाई स्वागत। अस्ति यो भन्दा अगाडिको हामीले क्लास में चाहिँ प्रूफ द फलोइंग इक्वेसन्स भनेर हामीले गर्दै थियौ र हामीले केही इक्वेसन्सहरुलाई प्रूफ गर्यौ र बाँकी रहेको आज इक्वेसन्सहरुलाई चाहिँ आज प्रूफ गरिनेछ। आजको सबैभन्दा फर्स्ट में यो प्रूफ भनेको हाइड्रोलिक प्रेस इज अ फोर्स मल्टिप्लायर। यो इक्वेसनलाई प्रूफ गर्दाखेरि so how to prove this, let us see here. To prove that hydraulic press is a force multiplier, we take the help of Pascal's law. We already have stated the Pascal's law and we know the statement, and according to this liquid transmits pressure equally in all direction. So we take the help of that, that is liquid transmits the pressure equally in all directions. So let us design a hydraulic device. It is based on a Pascal's law in which inside is filled by the liquid. Let us say that is a water, this is a hydraulic press. This hydraulic press is used to lift a heavy load. So we are just going to prove that this hydraulic press is a force multiplier. That means the force we input, that is the force we input here, F1, is multiplied and we can lift this heavy load by applying very small amount of effort. So this F1 is the effort here, effort. Let us consider the cross sectional area of these two pistons. These are the two pistons, piston 1 and piston 2. So these two pistons have the cross sectional area A1 and A2. Now I am escaping the language part here. So now from the Pascal's law we can write that pressure on piston 1 equals to pressure on piston 2. So pressure on piston 1 equals to pressure on piston 2. So we are putting a load in a cross sectional area A2, that means piston having cross sectional area A2. From the figure also we can see that the cross sectional area is greater. So pressure on piston 1 equals to pressure on piston 2, and by the definition of pressure we know that pressure is defined as force per unit area. So pressure on piston 1 will be F1 by A1, and pressure on piston 2 will be F2 by A2. Now the liquid is used inside here. We know why the liquid is used inside the hydraulic press, why not the gas? Liquid is used because liquid is incompressible. There are two reasons: liquid is incompressible and liquid transmits the pressure equally in all directions. Instead, if we use the gas is compressible. We can compress the volume of the gas. So the gas is not used here, we use the liquid, because liquid is incompressible and liquid transmits the pressure equally in all directions. From the figure, we know that the cross-sectional area A2 is greater than A1. We must know that A2 is greater than A1. Now see here, F2 by A2 equals to F1 by A1, okay? So here, or F2 equals to A2 by A1 into F1. So we must know here A2 by A1. We do not know the exact value, but we can predict, will this value be greater than 1, less than 1, or equal to 1? If we see here, we already know the condition that the cross-sectional area A2 is greater than cross-sectional area A1, that is cross-sectional area of piston 1 is greater than the cross-sectional area of piston 2. So the numerator value will be always the larger value, larger, and this will be the smaller. So what will happen when the larger value is divided by the smaller value? Will that be less than 1, greater than 1, or equal to 1. See here, A2 by A1, this is the larger value. Let us say it is 5. A1, it is a smaller value. So, let us say 4. So, 5 divided by 4 will always be greater than 1. So, greater than 1 value, greater than 1 value. So, that means A2 by A1 is greater than 1. The ratio will be greater than 1. So, that means F2 is equal to greater than 1 value. We do not know the exact value, but we know that we can say that this value is greater than 1 into F1. Greater than 1 value into some value will obviously greater than that value. That means greater than 1 into 5. Greater than 1 means, so let us say 1.01 into 5 will be 5.05, which is greater than 5. This 1.01 into 5 will be 5.05, which is greater than 5. So, we can write this, F2 is greater than F1. So, what does this equation say? This equation say that the force is multiplied. So, F2 is greater than F1. So, we can write that hydraulic press is a force multiplier. And then, this equation proved. So, let us go to the next one, which equation we will prove now. Another equation which we are going to prove is Q equals to mstt. So, we are going to prove the 9th equation, that is Q equals to mstt. Okay. To prove this, we must know what does these letters indicate. This Q is the amount of heat, M is the mass of the body, S is the specific heat capacity, and dT is the change in temperature, change in temperature means final temperature minus initial temperature. So, we can write dT is T2 minus T1. So, to prove this, we must write in this way. If M is the mass of the body whose initial temperature is T1, if M mass of the body has initial temperature, T1. So, this body can either lose, that means the temperature can be decreased by losing the heat, or the temperature can be increased by gaining the heat. So, let us say the increased or decreased value of temperature be T2, and when heat is lost or gained, the temperature reaches to T2. So, we must know that the amount of heat, that is Q, gained by the body is directly proportional to the mass of the body. That means, if the mass of the body is more, the amount of heat lost will also be more. If the mass of the body is less, the amount of heat lost or gained will also be less. So, directly proportional. Also, Q is directly proportional to change in temperature, dT, that means T2 minus T1. So, it also depends upon the change in temperature, increased or decreased. So, by combining these two equations, we can write is Q directly proportional to mdt. And we all know that to remove this proportionality symbol, we need a constant. and we can remove this proportionality symbol by equal to n a constant. So we can write q equals to ms dt, our equation proved, where this s is the specific heat capacity of the substance and its value is different for the different substance. So this proves the q equals to ms dt. Now let us go to the next equation which we need to prove, the 10th one. Prove I by O equals to B by U for a lens. That means we have to prove this I by O equals to B by U for lens. This is a very important relation. So to prove this, we have to draw the figure of the lens. So let us draw the figure of the lens first. This is the lens. Now let us draw the principal axis. Principal axis goes through the optical center, and optical center is the geometrical center of the lens. So optical center is the geometrical center of the lens, and the line that passes through the optical center by joining the two center of curvature, that means center of the spherical surfaces. So lens is formed by the joining of, that means convex lens is formed by the overlapping of two spherical surface. So let us see here, this is F focus, this is 2F, this is F2, this is 2F2. To prove this, we have to complete the ray diagram first. To complete the ray diagram, we can put the object in between F and 2F, and we all know that when the object lies between F and 2F, where will the image be formed? When the object lies between F and 2F, the image will be formed behind 2F on the opposite side of the lens, and the image formed will be real. The real image will be on the opposite side of the lens. So let us complete the ray diagram here. So this is a ray of light which is parallel to the principal axis. The ray of light parallel to the principal axis will always pass through the focus. So it passes through the focus. Another ray of light will pass through the optical center, and we all know that the ray of light that passes through the optical center will go straight without bending, and they will meet somewhere. This line and the line, another line we are going to pass from here, will meet somewhere. So let us see, they meet here. So this is the image that is formed on the opposite side of the lens. And if we see the nature of the image, we can say that the image is real, the image is inverted. Let us write the nature of the images here. This image is real, inverted, and magnified. Real because it is formed on the opposite side of the lens, inverted because the head and tail of this object is just being inverted. So A will be here, the image is inverted here, A dash B dash. Now the size of the object, is smaller than the size of the image. That means the image is larger. So this image is magnified. Now we have to introduce some terms here. See here, what is the distance between this focus and optical center called? It is called as focal length. Distance between the object and this is called as object distance. The distance between this and the image is called as image distance. The object distance is denoted by U, image distance is denoted by V. Object distance is denoted by U and image distance is denoted by V. So the height of the object, let us say, is O. This is the height of the object, and the height of the image is I. So we have to write these things in the language part. I am skipping the language part so that we can go faster. I'm not writing the language part here. So you have to write, you have to introduce what is U, you have to introduce U, B, you have to introduce F, you have to introduce this AB, height of the object, A dash B dash, height of the image. So that is I. Now prove this. To prove this relation, we take the help of two triangles here, two triangles. I'm shadowing the triangles which we are going to take so that it will be easy. So we are going to take these two triangles, these two triangles, the shaded triangles, these two triangles we are going to take the help of. Now from the triangle A, B and O, but before that let us know the definition of magnification also. We know that magnification is the ratio of size of image to the size of object. Magnification is also defined as the ratio of size of that means image distance to the object distance, size of image to the size of object, image distance to the object distance. So this M is I by O and M is B by U, so it combinedly gives I by O equals to B by U, but we have to prove this mathematically. So see here, we are going to take the help of two triangles, that is triangle A B O and triangle A dash B dash O. We are going to take the help of these two triangles. From here we can see clearly that these both triangles, these triangles, the shaded triangles, are similar. How? This angle and this angle, these angles are vertically opposite angle. So we can write angle A O, angle from figure, triangle A, angle A O B is equal to angle A dash O B dash. The reason is vertically opposite angle. Okay. Next condition. Condition second, angle B A O, angle B A O is equal to angle B dash A dash O. The reason, both are 90 degree, so this is also equal. Third one, is angle A B O equal to angle A dash B dash O. So here these two angles are equal, and the reason, you all know this, what is the reason? Remaining angle, the remaining angle of a triangle, that will also be the equal. So this is remaining angle. So from these three relation, what we just can write, both triangle ABO and triangle A dash B dash O are similar. Reason is angle, by the AA property, angle property. So if the angles are similar, then the ratio of their sides will also be equal, ratio of the sides. So we can write now, since triangle ABO and triangle A dash B dash O are similar, we can write, I'm drawing this figure now, you can see the figure in the screen, I'm drawing this. So these two triangles are similar. Now we can write the ratio of the sides, AB by A dash B dash equals to AO by A dash O equals to BO by B dash O. From the figure you can clearly see that what is AB? AB is the image I. What is A dash B dash? A dash B dash is, size of object. What is AO then? AO is the object distance. AO, let us see the figure once. Let us see the figure. In the figure, we can clearly see that AB is size of object, A dash B dash is the size of image, and then AO is the, so I am going to draw the figure once again. Let us see here, a bit confusion about the figure which we have just previously done. Let us see, I am drawing a small figure O, F and 2F. I have represented this as A, this as B. AB were changed here. So this was F, this was 2F, image was formed here, this is A dash, this is B dash. So from the figure we can write AB by A dash B dash equals to AB, then AO by A dash O. So we can see here, this is AB is size of object, A dash B dash is size of image, AO is, we know this, AO is the object distance, this is the image distance, AO is represented by U, A dash O is represented by V. Then we can write I by O equals to B by U. So this proves the required equation for the lens. So the confusion was in the figure which we have seen in the screen and here. I have represented A and B just inversely. In the screen you have seen the figure is A here and B here, so that was a confusion. So everything is okay now. So this proves the equation I by O equals to B by U. Now let us go to the another one which we are going to prove today. And I hope you have understood this equation also. So let us go to the next question now. The next question to be proved is prove that the step up transformer always increases the input voltage. Step up transformer always increases the input voltage. We all know that the function of a transformer is to alter the voltage, that means input voltage into high or low. So how can we prove that the step of transformer always increases the input voltage? So here is a boundary, the step up transformer. So let us draw the figure of step up transformer first. Okay, this is the figure of a step up transformer. If you notice here, the number of turns in this side coil and the number of turns in these side coils are different. So the number of turns in a step up transformer, the number of turns in primary coil, so this is the primary one, this is the primary coil, this is a secondary coil. The number of turns in primary coil is always less than the number of turns in the secondary coil. We must know this condition, that in a step up transformer, the number of turns in primary coil is always less than the number of turns in the secondary coil. But opposite in the step down transformer, the number of turns in the primary coil is the number of turns in the primary coil is more than the number of turns in secondary coil. Okay, so you can see the figure. The figure is the of step of transformer. In a step of transformer, the number of turns in the primary coil is less than the number of turns in the secondary coil. So now this is the basic condition to prove the given statement. The condition that number of turns in primary coil is less than the number of turns in secondary coil in a step of transformer. So this turns is less. In this side, the turns is more. Number of turns is more. Now, we know the important relation of a step, that means transformer, in terms of this number of turns and voltage. We all know that, the very important relation. The language part we will write, we will define the step of transformer, we will draw the figure, we will write that the number of turns is less in primary and secondary number of turns more, and then we will write the important relation in terms of voltage and number of turns of the transformer, that is N1 by V1 equals to N2 by V2. The ratio of number of turns in primary coil to the number of turns, as that means voltage in primary coil, is equal to the ratio of number of turns in secondary coil to the number of amount of voltage in secondary coil. So we have to show that it increases the input voltage, that means it multiplies the voltage. So see here, we can write this V2 by N2 equals to V1 by N1. Okay? So we can write this, or V2 equals to N2 by N1 into V1. Similar to that of hydraulic press is a force multiplier. We already have done this. So if you see here, the ratio of N2 by N1, will this value be greater than 1, less than 1, or equal to 1? What will be the value, that means the ratio of N2 and N1? We must know this. N2 is the number of turns in secondary coil, and from the condition we all already know that number of turns in the secondary coil is more, the number of turns in primary coil is less. So what will be the ratio now? This is more, this is more, and this is less. So more value, or the greater value divided by the smaller value, 5 divided by 4, or let us say 5 divided by 4.99, it is a smaller than 5. So greater value divided by smaller value, what will happen? The value will always be greater than 1. We do not need the exact answer here, we do not require the exact answer here, but we must know the greater value divided by the smaller value will always have the ratio, that means the answer, which is greater than 1. The answer will be greater than 1. So this ratio, this will also have the answer greater than 1. So we can write V2 equals to greater than 1 value into V1. Greater than 1 value multiplied by V1. To understand this, now see here, I am rubbing this. Now see here, greater than 1 into 5. Let us take the example here, greater than 1. Greater than 1 value means 1.01, let us say, or we can write 1.001 into 5. What will be the answer? The answer will be 5.005. This is the answer. And this answer is greater than 5, obviously. The answer is greater than 5. So we are doing the same thing here. V2 is equal to greater than 1 into V1. V2 is greater than 1 into V1. Greater than 1 value multiplied by V1 will also have the answer, which is greater than V1. So that means V2 is greater than V1. So what we can see from here, the output voltage is increased. That means the output voltage is more than the input voltage. So this proves the statement which we have just written. In the same question, the question also can be asked is step down transformer always decreases the voltage? Prove mathematically. So in that condition, what we have to do? We have to draw the figure of a step down transformer. In a step down transformer, the number of turns in the primary coil will be more than that of secondary coil. So when the number of turns will be more than that of secondary coil, the ratio will be less than 1. The ratio will be less than 1. When the ratio will be less than 1, B2 will be less than B1. So that will be your homework. So write the question. I am just going to give the same question for the step down transformer, and in the next class we will discuss if there will be any problem. So the question is like this: step down transformer always decreases the input voltage. Prove mathematically. So this question is an important question, so you have to understand this. So now we have completed all the proofs which we require. Till today we have completed different question patterns and we have discussed the different question patterns also, but now we are going to discuss about the questions. What are the factors on which the following depends? As you can see on the screen, what are the factors on which the following depends? Let us remember the answers now. Once memorize the answer. What are the factors on which the following depends? So if there is a question like this, then first of all you have to remember the formula related with it. So let us see the questions there. What are the factors on which the following depends? Gravitational force, acceleration due to gravity, weight of the body, mass of the body, pressure and liquid pressure. So this kind of questions also you can face in exams. So to know these answers, let us say for gravitational force, F equals to, we know that Z m1 m2 divided by d square. So from here we can clearly say what are the factors on which the gravitational force depends. You have different kinds of formulas. G equals to Gm by R square, P equals to F by A, W equals to M into G. Similarly, P equals to HDG, B, U, upthrust. Upthrust equals to VDG. By looking these formula, we can clearly write the answers now. See here, gravitational force depends upon the masses of the body. It does not depend upon the value of the G, because G is a constant. G is a constant quantity. Okay? So it depends upon the masses of bodies, each body, and the distance between them. This small g depends upon the mass of the planet and radius of that planet. Pressure depends upon the force and area. Weight depends upon the mass and acceleration due to gravity. P depends upon the height of the liquid column, density of the liquid and acceleration due to gravity. Upthrust depends upon the volume of the body, density of the liquid and acceleration due to gravity. So let us see the answers there. The gravitational force depends upon the masses of each body and the distance between their centers. Acceleration due to gravity, it depends upon the mass of the heavenly body and radius of it. Weight of the body depends upon the mass of the body and acceleration due to gravity. The mass of the body depends upon the number of atoms or molecules and mass of each. Pressure depends upon the force applied and the surface area. Liquid pressure depends upon the height of the liquid column, density of the liquid and acceleration due to gravity. So in that case, mass of the body, on which factor does the mass of the body depends? Sometimes students write in this way, mass of the body, by looking this equation, mass of the body depends upon, so they do the like this, that is not the right one. M equals to W by G, and just sometimes we can be confused and we will write mass depends upon the weight of the body and acceleration due to gravity. No, it is not. Mass of the body depends upon the number of atoms or the molecules and mass of each atoms or molecules. So it depends upon that. So let us see the next question now. So let us now tell the answers of these factors on which the upthrust depends, density depends, rise and fall of mercury level in barometer depends, age of the sun depends, amount of heat gain or loss depends, power of the lens depends. So upthrust, we know the formula VdZ, density we know, mass per unit volume, amount of heat gain or loss we know Q equals to MSDT, power of lens we know it depends upon the focal length P equals to 1 by F. So let us see the answers now. Upthrust depends upon the volume of the object, density of the liquid and acceleration due to gravity, density, mass of the body and volume of the body, rise and fall of mercury level in barometer, it depends upon the change in atmospheric pressure. So if the atmospheric pressure decreases or increases, the level of mercury inside the barometer also increases or decreases. The age of the sun depends upon the amount of hydrogen present in the sun, we know that sun consists of hydrogen. So age of the sun depends upon the amount of hydrogen present in the sun, and our sun is the now the medium age star. Amount of heat gain or loss, it depends upon the mass of the body, specific heat capacity of the body and change in temperature. We know the equation Q equals to MSDT. So from there we can write mass of the body, specific heat capacity of the body and change in temperature, power of lens, focal length. So these were the answers. So sometimes for this amount of heat depends Q, the question may ask on which four factors, on which four factors. We just have said amount of heat gain or loss depends upon three factors, mass of the body, specific heat capacity of the body and change in temperature. What if in exam it is asked that what are the four factors? If it asks what are the four factors, then we can just write dt is t2 minus t1. So we can write amount of heat depends upon the mass of the body, specific heat capacity of the body, final temperature and initial temperature, if it is asked for the four factors. Let us see other questions now. What are the factors on which the strength of electromagnet depends? The amount of current produced in a bicycle dynamo depends. Electrical energy consumed, we know the formula for electrical energy consumed, NPT, chemical reactivity of the element, rate of chemical reaction. And what are the factors on which the development of the drone worker and queen bee depends? So let us recall the answers now. Do we remember the answers? Let us see the questions once again and then we will see the answers. What are the factors on which the strength of electromagnet, amount of current produced in a bicycle dynamo, electrical energy consumed, chemical reactivity of the element, the rate of chemical reaction, development of drone worker and queen bee depends? So let us see the answers now. The strength of electromagnet depends upon the amount of current supplied and the number of turns of the coils. Electromagnet is a temporary magnet which is made by passing electric current. So the strength of electromagnet can be increased by increasing the amount of current supplied and by increasing the number of turns. So it depends upon these two factors, amount of current supplied and the number of turns of the coil. Amount of current produced in a bicycle dynamo, we know that bicycle dynamo is a device which converts mechanical energy into electrical energy, and inside a bicycle dynamo there is a magnet used. So the magnet is turned by the coils there, that means the wire, the coils are made there. So what are the factors now? Amount of current produced in a bicycle dynamo depends upon the strength of the magnet, the number of the turns of the coil and the distance between the magnet and the coil. So these are also the factors by which we can increase the strength of the amount of current produced in a bicycle dynamo. Similarly, electrical energy consumed, electrical energy consumed means the electricity that is consumed by our electrical device in our home. So what are the factors? The factors are the number of electrical device, power of each device and the amount of time used by the each device, that means amount of time we use each device. So more the time we use, it also increases the amount of electrical energy consumed. Similarly, chemical reactivity of the element, chemical reactivity. That means whether the element is more reactive or less reactive, it depends upon its size of atom and valence electron. So chemical reactivity of the element depends upon the size of atom and valence electron. What are the factors on which the rate of chemical reaction depends now? The rate of chemical reaction depends upon the temperature, light, catalyst. So these are the factors which always increases the rate of chemical reaction. Catalyst, the positive catalyst increases the rate of chemical reaction, and the negative catalyst decreases the rate of chemical reaction. Similarly, there are other factors also which increases the rate of chemical reaction or decreases, like surface area, aqueous state. So these are also the other factors. You can write those factors also. Another one, development of drone worker and queen bee depends. So what are the factors? There are two conditions to know whether the given, that means whether the egg of bee will be developed into the drone worker or queen. It depends upon the diet that honey bee feeds on and whether the egg is fertilized or unfertilized egg. If the bee, that means in the queen bee, if the queen bee lay eggs, it lays two different kinds of eggs. So queen bee lays two different kinds of eggs, that is fertilized and unfertilized. And in previous class we have also known the number of chromosomes of fertilized and unfertilized egg of honey bee. We already know that. Now the fertilized egg develops into two different kinds, that is females. It develops into females, that is either worker is a female bee, or queen. So queen lays eggs, fertilized and unfertilized eggs. From fertilized eggs, females develop, that is worker or queen, and from unfertilized it develops into the drone. But from the fertilized egg also, whether the given, that means whether the egg, fertilized egg will be worker or queen, also depends upon the diet. Now in this stage it depends upon the diet. The queen bee is supplied with the royal jelly only, but worker, it is supplied with royal jelly for a few days and the bee bread later on. So it also depends upon the diet, that is feed on. Drone is not supplied by the royal jelly, it also is supplied by the bee bread. So these are the factors on which the development of the worker, queen or drone bee depends upon for the honey bee. So you have to remember this also. So I think we have completed what are the factors on which the following depends also. So let us go to the next pattern of the question. Name the device or instrument which is used to, I think you all know this. Name the device or instrument which is used to, first one, measure mass. What is the device which is used to measure mass? The device which is used to measure mass is beam balance. So let us see the questions first. The device used to measure mass, what is the device used to measure weight? The device which is used to measure the atmospheric pressure. What is the device which is used to fill the atmospheric air into the rubber tube of the automobiles or bicycle? Raise the underground water, that means to pull the water from inside earth. So let us see the answers now. What are the answers? The device which is used to measure mass is beam balance. The device which is used to measure weight is spring balance. The device which is used to measure the atmospheric pressure is mercury barometer. To fill the atmospheric air into the rubber tube of the automobiles or bicycle, that is air pump or bicycle pump. And to raise the underground water, that means to lift the water from inside earth, is water pump. Let us see other questions also. Name the device which is used to draw the blood, that means to pull out the blood or inject the medicine to the patients. To measure the heat, to measure the temperature of the human body, to measure the maximum and minimum temperature of a particular place within 24 hours, to instrument which is used to correct the short-sightedness or myopia, to correct the long-sightedness or hypermetropia, and to convert the mechanical energy into electrical energy. So let us recall the answers now. I am giving you just few time to see the questions there. You try to memorize the answer. Now let us see the answer. The device which is used to draw the blood or inject the medicine to the patients is syringe. It is used in the hospitals. The device which is used to measure the heat is calorimeter. The device which is used to measure the temperature of human body, thermometer. Device which is used to measure the maximum and minimum temperature of a particular place within 24 hours, maximum and minimum thermometer. To correct the short-sightedness or myopia. Concave lens, to correct the long-sightedness or hypermetropia. Convex lens, device which is used to convert the mechanical energy into the electrical energy, is dynamo or generator. Dynamo or generator converts the mechanical energy into electrical energy. Do you remember on which principle does the dynamo or generator depends? Dynamo or generator, in previous class we have studied, dynamo or generator is based on which principle? So that is the question for today also. So you have to find out the answer. You can see the previous class, it is available in different media. So recall from there and find out the answer. Next question. Converts the electrical energy into mechanical energy. Device which converts the electrical energy into mechanical energy, which converts AC into DC, AC current, alternating current into direct current, which converts AC into DC and again DC into AC, which alters the voltage of AC, that means which changes the voltage of the AC, input AC, which converts the high voltage AC into the low voltage AC, which converts low voltage AC into the high voltage AC, device which is used to measure the amount of electrical energy consumed and which measures the human blood pressure. So these are the questions. So let us find out the answers now. What are the answers of these? Device which is used to convert the electrical energy into mechanical energy is a electric motor. Device which converts AC current into DC. Electrical charger, we charge our mobile and it stores the battery. That means it stores the electrical charge in the form of DC in battery. So charger, which converts AC into DC and again DC into AC, that is an inverter. Inverter converts the AC into DC and DC into AC, which alters the voltage of AC. Alters means which changes, either increases or decreases the voltage of AC, is a transformer. The device which converts high voltage AC into the low voltage AC is a step down transformer. The device which converts low voltage AC into high voltage AC is a step up transformer, which measures the amount of electrical energy consumed. So in our home, how can you know that how much amount of electrical energy is consumed by the electrical device that are operated in our home or that are used in our home? Is electric meter, we see the electric meter there. And another one, device which measures the human blood pressure, that is sphygmomanometer. So don't be in confusion about the spelling of this device which is used to measure the blood pressure, that is sphygmomanometer. 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 So you have to write the correct spelling also. Pravidhima sahayog garne pravidhik mitra ra Subhas Singh sir lai pani vishesh dhanyawad didai ma aaja ko yes class bata bida hun chahanchu. Sathai vidyarthi bhai bahinihar lai boli English ra Nepali ko class hune bhani jankari garauna chahanchu. Dhanyawad.